Very good morning to you. You're watching Newsline. We are about 6 minutes late because the news last night overran. But we are here with you now and we are ready to talk to someone interesting, a vociferous politician, if I may call him that. Mr. Dilan Perera, UPFA parliamentarian. Good morning to you, sir.
Good morning, Chathuranga.
Let me get to the point straight away because we are already 6 minutes in. Mr. Perera, now you have been a person who has been in politics for a long period of time. Especially if you take a look at the recent past, it's regard to the incidents that happened after the 26th of October. Just before the 26th of October, we saw politicians who were not on the president's side, all of a sudden coming onto the president's side. Then after the decision of the Supreme Court, going back to the side they were on. We remember people coming before the media and even saying, Kome Sirisena. And then thereafter, on political stages, calling the president a doctor who can remove the cancer of Ranil Wickremesinghe. What is your view on what happened to these politicians and their double standards as a person who has been in politics for a long time?
Chathuranga, Sri Lanka Freedom Party has gone through numerous splits in the past as well. So what happened on the 26th of October was not only changing individuals. It was not only a case of replacing an individual called Ranil Wickremesinghe with an individual called Mahinda Rajapaksa. It was a political decision that took place because after the UPFA decided to get out of the national government, the constitution itself forced the president of the country to appoint a new prime minister. And at that juncture, and even now, majority of the parliamentarians commanded, majority of the parliamentarians had trust in Mr. Mahinda Rajapaksa. Even today, up to now, Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe commands the majority only with the support of the TNA. So he still doesn't have the 113 that he was talking about even during the 45 days after the 26th of October. So most of the parliamentarians who were not very sure about Mr. Maithripala Sirisena's attitude towards SLFP until the 26th of October didn't realize that Mr. Maithripala Sirisena, as the leader of the SLFP, wanted the SLFP principles and the SLFP social, democratic, political philosophy to move forward. But he was also in a national government with the UNP, so he knew that when two parties work together, he had to always be flexible. Whereas the other partner of the national government, that is Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe's UNP, did not realize the fact that they were a national government. They acted as if they were in a UNP-only government. When Mr. Maithripala Sirisena bent backwards to accommodate Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe on so many occasions because they were a national government, Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe just ignored the fact that there was a president above him, and he just ignored the fact that there was a national government in place, and he ran the show as if it was a UNP-only government. And even some of the UNPers were not satisfied with the way that Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe was governing. Why? He governed completely ignoring the president, he even ignored the UNP seniors. He governed with four or five of his very close school friends, college friends. I also went to the same college. But you can't govern a country like that. So after Mr. Maithripala Sirisena made Mr. Mahinda Rajapaksa the president, people in the SLFP MPs who never thought Mr. Maithripala will do so, realized that Mr. Maithripala Sirisena will definitely do what he has to do to push the social democratic principle of the party forward. After the 45 days when Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe had to be reappointed, then of course some of these MPs thought, well, now it is better that they get back to the new party that they backed during the past local government elections, because the SLFP was a national government. They thought, well, we must now go to that anti-UNP new party. But now again they are realizing the fact that if we don't put the SLFP and the new party together, that we can't beat Mr. Anil Wickremesinghe's, Mr. Anil Wickremesinghe's policies and the Mr. Anil Wickremesinghe's way of governing this country.
Mr. Perera, you spoke about the seniors of the United National Party and the affiliation of the United National Party with the TNA. Especially, we saw this during the political situation of the recent last year. Now, my question to you is very simple. We saw in Parliament a brawl taking place. We saw a parliamentary committee being appointed, headed by the Deputy Speaker, and investigations being carried out. We are even told that this is going to go up to the Attorney General of the country to see whether action is taken. Now, we also see, violating standing orders, Sumandiran, parliamentarian of the TNA, media spokesperson of the TNA, going up to the leader of the House, as the UNP called Lakshman Kiriyala, senior member of the UNP, pointing fingers at him and having a discussion while the Prime Minister, who was ousted at the time, Ranil Wickremesinghe, was seated in the House. So things like this have also happened in the Parliament. While the finger is pointed, yes, action should be taken against the people who are having a brawl in Parliament. What are your views on this TNA-UNP relationship?
Well, I only have to say, Chathuranga, when you point a finger at somebody, they don't realize there's only one finger pointed at the other side, but there are three fingers pointed at yourself. It is exactly what has happened to the UNP. Brawls in Parliament, not only in Sri Lanka, but then all over the world, are something now very common.
But we cannot justify it.
No, not at all. I'm just trying to say brawls in Parliament are not very uncommon now. But then, we must condemn it, and we must see that such things doesn't happen. So it's up to the Parliament to have committees and then probe into it. And if disciplinary action has to be taken, well, it has to be taken. Even in the past, when brawls have taken place in Parliament, sometimes disciplinary action has been taken. So there is no question about it. But as you very correctly said in the question itself, why did such a brawl take place? When the Speaker of the House just ignores the leader of the House, the past leader of the House, I mean, then now at that particular moment, the leader of the House was Dinesh Gunawardena. He ignored not only the present leader of the House, he also ignored the past leader of the House, Lakshman Kiriyala, and in an indirect way, accepted Mr. Sumandiran as leader of the House. Mr. Sumandiran played the role of the leader of the House, which is not acceptable to Parliament. So, when such things happen, then naturally, parliamentarians tend to behave in a manner that is not suitable for Parliament. I'm not saying it's right, yes. But it is the Speaker's decision to accept Mr. Sumandiran as the unofficial leader of the House that led to all these things. Then see what happened. What happened after that? Mr. Sumandiran, he proposed that all the standing orders be suspended, and we have known in the history of this country there is not a single occasion where all the standing orders of the Parliament are suspended. You have to get up and say that these section of standing orders suspended, and then 20 members get up and accept it. But here he got up and said that all the standing orders be suspended. When all the standing orders are suspended, how can the Parliament run? Parliament run on standing orders. So he's saying, let us suspend all the standing orders. When you suspend all the standing orders, the Parliament can't run. And then Mr. Dinesh Gunawardena, the leader of the House, was not accepted. Okay, then at least accept the former leader of the House, Kiriyala, he was not accepted. Here Mr. Sumandiran ran the show. So, I mean, if you talk about the brawl, take action against the people you want to take action, but also take action against the people who are the cause of the brawl. So I'm saying, you know, if you look at Parliament today, the UNP has a official Prime Minister called Ranil Wickremesinghe, but the unofficial Prime Minister's role is played by Mr. Sumandiran. I mean, I'll be very happy if a Tamil-speaking gentleman is the Prime Minister of this country, because like in the United States, when Mr. Obama became the President, well, it showed that the majority of the whites also accepted Mr. Obama. So I have no problem in a Tamil-speaking person becoming the Prime Minister if the country elects him. But Mr. Sumandiran's action today has led to the downfall of the Tamil-speaking people itself. Tamil-speaking people has a problem because they speak Tamil as a language. Well, some of their rights were taken away from the date of our independence. Mm. So there have been so many talks international forums in Sri Lanka to bring about a solution to the ethnic issue. Mr. Sumandiran's action today, leave the signal is out. Mr. Sumandiran's action today has caused immense damage to the problem of the Tamil-speaking people. Today, the Tamil-speaking people are slowly being pushed away from the Sinhalese due to the actions of Mr. Sumandiran, because Mr. Sumandiran is not acting in accordance with the wish of the Tamil people. He is only acting in accordance with Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe's five or six of the friends, the kitchen cabinet, if I may call it, who run the show.
Mr. Dilan Perera, with that we have to go in for a short commercial break. But before that, we have to remember and remind, because Mr. Perera has brought us to an interesting point where everyone now is talking about the black media. Back in the day when there were aggressive political parties, we remember how Mr. Dilan Perera had the courage and the strength to take back the microphone, the Newsfirst microphone that was removed from a podium, and leave it back, ensuring the people's right to know. And we respect you for that. And with that, we have to go in for a short commercial break. When we come back, we'll talk about the black media. So welcome back. You're watching Newsline. We are in discussion with UPFA parliamentarian Dilan Perera. Before we went into the break, we promised that we'll bring you, talk to you about the black media that everyone is talking about. We saw Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe talking about it. We saw the JVP talking about it. We saw even parliamentarian TNA parliamentarian M.S. Sumandiran talking about the black media and labeling media institutions as the black media. Now, Mr. Perera, we have seen from the day the October 26th incident happened, the political situation, we have seen various NGOs having protests, demonstrations of various types. Some even took an international aspect, opposite the President's House, opposite all these key locations in Colombo. And in all those instances, it was clear that they were behind an agenda, which to a certain degree is understood. There was a situation in the country. We thought at that time, it was seen, that they were fighting for something they believe in. But immediately, when the reappointment of the Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe was done, we saw these calls for democracy being dissolved. And thereafter, these same people who called for democracy have the ability to come before a media institution and call a media institution unethical journalism, and then hand over a letter, basically force a letter. And once that media institution does not accept that letter, because no media institution is bound to accept a letter, you won't accept a letter if someone comes with a mask and gives you a letter. When that happens, all they can do is take up on social media, and then it follows. My question to you is very simple. These NGOs and their involvement with the statements made referring to certain media institutions as black media, how do you see it? You have been a politician in this country for the past, I don't know how long.
Well, Chathuranga, it only gave the truth to the people, because the very people who were saying that they are the champions of right to information, they said, well, we are the people who brought in the act for right to information. So the very people who said that people must have right to information are today coming in front of media institutions and saying, no, right to information has to be according to their whims and fancies only. So, I mean, I saw some of those people who came in front of these institutions. I am very clearly saying that most of those people are very close confidants of the present media minister. The lady whose photograph was shown on newspapers, the lady who tried to attack journalists, when one journalist had taken a photograph, is Manohari Hevavasan. Mangala Samaravira is very close confidant, Juan Ferdinand's friend. After Mr. Mangala Samaravira took over as Minister of Media, even today, that that lady is running a juice bar on a piece of land at Torrington belonging to the Rupani Corporation. When Mr. Mangalasamarveera was the Minister of Housing, she got a government flat through Mr. Mangalasamarveera in Mattegoda. So, I'm saying because these people have to be exposed. These are the very people who talk about right to information and who are saying that they are champions of democracy and so on and so forth. But these are the very people who go against democratic institutions and try to wear a mask. And on the day that this demonstration took place, they were unmasked. So it's very clear the UNP government is today a den of thieves. The UNP government is today clearly working towards a dictatorial, undemocratic country. So it is high time that all the people got together and today say, well, since the Supreme Court has stopped the general elections taking place, it's high time that we all got together and asked the Commission of Elections or the Chairman of the Election Commissions, please have the Provincial Council elections so that the people will decide who is right and who is wrong. People will decide who is black and who is white. People will decide who should govern this country and who should not govern this country. People will decide who is the rogue and who is not a rogue. So I am pleading with the Chairman of the Election Commission. You have a member in your Election Commission who went to the Supreme Court and asked that election be postponed. So if a member of the Election Commission, National Election Commission, go to courts and ask that election be not be held, why can't the Election Commission go to courts and ask that election be held? Because the only solution is the people to get a right, get their right to vote, so that the people will decide who is black and who is white.
Definitely, Mr. Perera, we also have to reiterate that we are not against any NGO organization. There are NGO organizations that carry out a lot of services to the people, and we also salute and respect these NGO organizations. But when things like this happen individually as a young person, people would get aggravated because you cannot simply reprimand a media institution for doing their job. You, as a person who is currently seated as the opposition, would understand that even the opposition leader himself, former President Mahinda Rajapaksa, spoke to the media when this incident was ongoing and reiterated how when you are in power, you would accuse our network and other media institutions of supporting the opposition, and vice versa when things happen. Now let's move aside from this black media for a while. I'll get back to that in a later minute. But the question to you is now political. We see a certain incident happening in the SLFP where President Maithripala Sirisena, opposition leader Mahinda Rajapaksa are the two main people to look at. And we also see people like Gotabaya Rajapaksa, Basil Rajapaksa's name being mentioned for a presidential election, eventual presidential election. We also see a group talking about former President Chandrika Bandaranaike and a group going towards Chandrika Bandaranaike. Is there people within the SLFP trying to create a division within the SLFP itself?
Well, since you mentioned Madam Kumaratunga's name, two or three of Madam Kumaratunga's confidants were also in front of your institutions calling you a black media that day. So these NGO people who are today talking big about democracy who want to sort of have democracy only in a dictatorial way that they want also have connections to Madam Kumaratunga. So what Madam Kumaratunga has forgotten today is that the Sri Lanka Freedom Party was started off by her own father, and it was her mother, Madam Srimao Bandaranaike, who nurtured the SLFP, who built the SLFP. So the Sri Lanka Freedom Party has its own principles, and today Sri Lanka Freedom Party has to be taken forward in the middle path as a social democratic party. So Madam Kumaratunga is today trying to make a Sri Lanka Freedom Party a puppet in the hands of the UNP through these NGO organizations, to which Mr. Maithripala Sirisena is opposed to. Mr. Maithripala Sirisena, when he became the common candidate, he had an agenda, and that agenda did not have anything to destroy the Sri Lanka Freedom Party. So today, Mr. Maithripala Sirisena, with the support of Mr. Mahinda Rajapaksa, will rally round all the forces together and try to chase these den of thieves out. I'm calling the UNP a den of thieves because under Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe, the UNP has become nothing but a den of thieves. They are all people who are taking the money of these people, and the greatest political highway robbery in this country, the central bank bond issue, which the Sirasa and came out first and told the people, Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe is the first accused in that robbery. So presidential election is 10 months away. People like Mr. Gotabaya Rajapaksa or somebody, if they have the aspirations, well, they can certainly come forward. But a presidential election is an election where not only the Sinhala Buddhist, but Sinhala, Tamil, Muslim, all these people vote. They vote for a president. So Mr. Gotabaya Rajapaksa maybe he's a person who can command some votes among the Sinhala Buddhist majority, but Mr. Gotabaya Rajapaksa, as we know, can't command a single vote of the Tamil and the Muslims. That is the truth. So we will have a candidate announced at the due time. Mr. Mahinda Rajapaksa and Mr. Maithripala Sirisena, as the leaders of our party, the grand alliance that we are trying to build in the future, will make the decision at the right time. And that candidate will be a candidate who can command the support of the Sinhalas, Tamil and Muslims all together.
One final question before we go in to conclude the program this morning, Mr. Perera. I said we'll talk about the black media NGOs, the rogue NGOs as we would like to call them, because they are referring to us as the black media. When it comes to matters like this, yes, the country has to have a certain amount of democracy, but when it comes to matters like this, one of our people could have been injured. It could have been a situation like that. Security for media institutions was a problem from a long time in this country. At least now, when it comes to these matters, when a media institution is revealing the corrupt activities of a government, where do you think the media should stand? Are we doing our job, or what do you think?
I think I am a politician, whether in government or in opposition. Whenever injustice happened to media institution, I used to always be there. As you said, not only the incident that you referred to, where certain politicians took away your mic, but I kept it back. When your headquarters in Panipitia, the Panama, was bombed, I was only government member to have gone to the spot within 1 hour. So whether you are in government or not, we are people's representatives, and people representatives always should support all these media institutions who are doing a job. I mean sometimes some of the things that your institution says, I may not like it personally, but your job is to tell the people, and the people will decide which is right or wrong. So I'm very sure, Chathuranga, the president is very concerned about some of these rogue NGOs. When he was in the Philippines, I was accompanying the Philippines. Even in the Philippines, he referred to some of the rogue NGOs helping the drug mafia of this country. So today, some of these NGOs are run by the money from the drug dealers. So I'm sure very soon, President Sirisena will take drastic action against these rogue NGOs who are being given money by some foreign organizations and also some of the drug dealers. So we are appealing to the people. The very people who call the media black are the very people who are supporting the drug dealers of this country today. And those dealers are the people who are destroying your child.
Serious allegations, serious claims by UPFA parliamentarian Dilan Perera. An interesting chat in the morning itself. We will keep an eye out on these rogue NGOs in the future as well. We will not give up. Once you, Mr. Perera, once open challenge is issued to you, you usually follow up. That's what we are used to doing, and we have never been intimidated, and we will continue to do our job. That's a promise that we keep to the general public. Ensure their right to know. Tomorrow too, we will be joining you with an interesting guest like Mr. Perera in the morning to keep you updated about the political situation. That's it for now. I'm Chathuranga. Take care.